A quick announcement, ladies and gentlemen. We are starting with the Angel Pitch session in Godrej, and I request investors to please join in. And we will now start with our first segment, that is India and the B2B story. The session chair, Mahavir Lunawat, the managing director of Pantomat Group. He has a rich expertise in business and corporate advisory, capital markets, M&A, etc., and has advised several domestic and overseas conglomerates. He has over 15 years of rich experience of working with top-notch conglomerates like ITC, Reliance Industries Limited, and PwC. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mahavir Lunawat.
You're introducing the speaker, right? Yeah, I think you called him first. You can use my notes. Everything is like right in front.
So good morning, all. I think the tone is pretty much set, and we all are eagerly looking forward to take the discussion forward. And I think first technical session is very rightly poised. May not be very fashionable and trendy to talk about B2B, but I'm sure there lies much more when we link the startup India's ecosystem story to B2B. And with great pleasure, I invite Mr. Ranu Vora and Sujit Kumar, the two achievers, and one thing in common is both are IITians. Request a great round of applause while both Ranu and Sujit come to the dais. Ranu is co-founder, MD, and CEO of Avendus, responsible for overall growth of the group, spent over two decades in the Indian financial services industry, concluding several market transactions in investment banking, private equity, and I'm sure all of us are aware that Avendus Group has grown from strength to strength and has emerged as one of the leading financial services house. With him, we have Sujit Kumar, co-founder Udaan. Sujit founded Udaan in 2016 with Vaibhav Gupta and Amod Malviya. Both of were former senior executives at Flipkart. Prior to founding Udaan, Sujit was president of operations at Flipkart, where he built operations, supply chain, logistics, which accounted for more than half of Flipkart's sale. He was instrumental in setting up the backbone of distribution network of e-commerce in India. Sujit has done his BTech in civil engineering from IIT Delhi. Big round of applause for Ranu and Sujit. Well, while I was given the task of introducing both of them, I thought let me share some quick data points. When it comes to B2B, we all are aware that B2B landscape in India is largely fragmented with millions of smaller units, whether MSMEs or unorganized sector. And on the other hand, B2B e-commerce attempts to integrate all these players in the ecosystem and transforming a digitized global world. Exceptions apart, typically B2B model is more capital efficient, has better customer stickiness, steady margins, multiple sources of revenue, and so on. Globally, including that in US, high cash burn consumer companies have underperformed compared to B2B companies that went public. As per research, B2C Indian firms need on an average over $200 million to achieve a $1 billion valuation, while B2B Indian firms need nearly half of that to reach the same valuation. Since 2014, the number of B2B tech startups have more than tripled from 900 to over 3,000, and investment in Indian B2B startup is up nearly 400% since 2014. Notably, of top 30 unicorns in India, 13 are B2B companies. Friends, B2B fintech has received more funding than B2C fintech, and some of the B2B companies making to a fast unicorn club much quicker than B2C include that none other than Udaan. And we thought, who's better than perhaps Sujit to share his views, and who better than Ranu to have a conversation with Sujit to kind of share with all of us the story of Udaan, some of the key aspects of B2B stories, and how all of us who have assembled this morning here can benefit out of B2B landscape in India. With this, friends, once again, very hearty welcome to both Ranu and Sujit, and I leave the house open to both of them to begin the conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and good morning to everyone here. Warm welcome, Sujit. He took the flight early this morning. Well, yes, Sujit and I went to IIT Delhi. Just a difference of 10 years, you know. Maybe a couple of zeros added to his net worth. But last time, and with no reservation, no bias, we had Binny Bansal, this fireside chat format. Again, you know, from IIT Delhi, and we had an interesting conversation around unicorns. And if I distinctly kind of, if my memory goes right, the number of unicorns at that point of time was, I think, 26. We were talking of 26 unicorns in India. My assessment is probably just short of 40 now in the country. And the big prediction which came out at that point of time, or you know, future looking which came out at that point of time, was this going to grow to 100 in the next 3 years. So no better than Sujit to tell us more, because you know, this group of founders, Sujit, has created India's fastest unicorn. So I want you to absorb that. It's India's fastest unicorn. And of course, been involved with Flipkart, and then this. So one big story after another. So we're here to ask a few questions, but Sujit, let me first ask you on the transition from Flipkart to Udaan. You know, what prompted that? What was the story there behind creation of Udaan itself?
Hey, hi everyone. And thanks, Ranu. After, like he said, that I am 10 year junior to him, but yeah, it's not like, so in 2003, when I passed out from IIT Delhi, I come from a very small town in Bihar, which I don't know, lots of people know, but it's called Bhabhua. It's like 70 kilometers from Banaras. So we don't have any background of how to build business. I think simple aspiration was, after having get your degree of engineering, to get a job. But somehow, I don't know how, in Delhi has spoiled us. after passing out, 1 or 2 years, from that region, if you come, aspiration of every parents are go to administrative services, go for UPSC and all. So I have also tried twice. So 2 years, almost 1 year, I was preparing for UPSC, but I realized this is not my aspiration, this is my parents' aspirations while I was studying. So I have taken option of geography and all. Suddenly after math and physics and engineering subjects, suddenly somebody had advised me to take a geography, and which is an easy course, and I realized this is not my cup of tea. So then I realized I want to do something else. At that time, in 2005, that startup was not the word. It was as popular as today's. But KPO and BPO was something where you get the project and get some money. So I've joined one friend, it's kind of startup, and he has, again, so like two startups, not three startups. So I have first startup was the KPO and BPO. We had a project, we were delivering, we were getting some money. No fundings were available for those companies. But after 2.5 years, recession came, and we were not having any project, any inflow of revenues. We were around 20 people, and we decided to move on. At that time, again, I've decided I'll not go and join any other company, rather than let me figure it out what to do. And in 2007, Sachin, who was my 1 year junior in IIT Delhi, and we were same college, same hostel. So hostels matters more. Yes. Like he's from Kara, just okay. We were having conversation.
And you're from Jwalamukhi.
Yeah, Jwalamukhi, yeah. So Sachin and me were like good friend also. So he has asked me, hey, why don't you come and see, explore what we are doing? And they were almost like 1 year, they had started in 2007. So I just tell them, okay, I'll come. I was in Delhi and then fly down like next day, within 2 or 3 days, I was in Bangalore. And then I see that, hey, what's the e-commerce? And somehow our journey has started because I decided to stay and work with Sachin and Binny. We are around 4 or 5 people. So I have seen the journey of how, at that time it was not funded also. First funding came into 2009. And Excel has put that money after first, the amount was less, and then after they have scaled up to $1 million around April or June 2009. So we have started building it, and I have seen the journey of around 7.5 years of how one company scales with the belief and all startup coming together. Even we have seen how 1 million to 1 billion we have raised. And one thing was very common. Those figures doesn't matter if you are in the right business and in executions. When your aspirations and overall, like what you are chasing are big, then those numbers fits into the scheme of things rather than seeing from that angle, hey, they have raised $1 billion. From outside, it's a big figure. But when you do the math and it takes like how much money it takes to build that kind of business, e-commerce, B2C, then still it's like oh, we need more money. I still, like it's a burning, and like B2C, everybody knows. In 2015, I decided to move on, and that year only, I think, Flipkart had hit the valuation of around $15 billion. So from 0 to 15, that was the journey I have seen. And move on, and after 7.5 years, I thought, let's see what next. At the similar time, Amod and VG, we call it Bavo VG, Bavo Gupta. Again, he's from IIT Delhi, 1 year senior to me. Amod, I know because he was the CTO of Flipkart. We have worked side by side for almost 6 years. So we haven't decided, hey, what to do next, rather than it was a very independent decision of individuals to move on. And after taking the break of like very high intense involved job, we decided first to work together, and then what next? Definitely after having a roller coaster ride in Flipkart, you always go for, hey, what is big in India and more relevant in the current context? One thing we realized also in during the journey of Flipkart, hey, some India, where 70-80% of the commerce or all the orders were coming from top 15-20 cities. But India is more than 15-20 cities. And then in that our research, what to do next, we find the trade of India is very, very different. And in that also, fewer of the category, and because I was there in 2015, fewer of the category was like leading the overall sales, smartphone, which is a like urban phenomena, and big ticket items, fashion, branded fashion, large appliances, But the core of the consumption, which is like grocery, unbranded fashion, home and kitchen, which is highly unbranded, 80-90%, all those categories which are not selling. And also it has been explained because if you'll see India, 90% of the consumptions is like less than 500 rupees. On an average, it's around 230 rupees what we consume, any of the goods, that's the average price. Like how it described 230 rupees or 250 rupees per kg consumption, because I am talking from the supply chain point of view. And per kg fulfillment cost in B2C was around 130, 150 rupees. It's very hard to fulfill a 250 rupees goods in 150 rupees cost. So only those items which are more than ASP is higher, then it makes sense. That's why mobile phone, a branded item which has an ASP of more than, let's say, 2,000 rupees or 1,500 rupees made those sense. So that's where I think we are putting our thought together and B2B came, because then we see that there are 20, 25 million retail shops which are doing all these maths, breaking the bulk, distributing to the consumers, and then that makes sense. Then your supply chain cost makes sense. And we wanted to figure out, that's where we have started our venture in 2016. We have decided in February 2016 to work on this idea, and that's how our journey started.
Super. Super. Some deep insights there in terms of, you know, and thanks for taking us through all the thinking. Tell us about things which you had to, coming from Flipkart, which was a traditional B2C market, to a new segment. What are the things, the two or three things you had to unlearn from one business to the other? You know, it's actually kind of, you know, when they take data points, sometimes they say if you've done two companies in a sequence, it's not... Success is not guaranteed,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
because yeah. Entrepreneurs carry the baggage of the old company. So tell us what you had to unlearn when you got into the new business.
I think, Ranu, that's a great question. But most of the things was kind of continuations, like building the organization, building the team, culture, all those things. And we have learned all those things in Flipkart in 7.5 years. We have done lots of mistakes and then rectified it, learned it, because in the first time, yeah, lots of iterative way you learn. And all those things, kind of continuation, all those learning we have implemented because of the similar kind of business, commerce, where operation was, heavy operation was there, their tech team, and then there is operation team, category team. All those things were the continuation. But nature of B2B and B2C. So if you'll, I think you guys, if you'll think, customer is an impulse kind of buy. Customer buys if we see something is cheaper. And if the price is, let's say, 1,000 rupees and some e-commerce is offering 800 rupees or 700, they will buy. Doesn't matter where the relationship are. But retailers, the very fundamental shift, it's not about cheaper goods. Eventually that matters, but relationship matters. And guarantee of that price, you will going to supply in future also. And the visibility also, hey, how you are offering that 700 rupees. Because what is the math? According to that math, that doesn't fit into. So if all those things are not clear, then they will not buy. It's not one-time purchase, because then they are disturbing the existing relationship. And in future, you are not giving the guarantee of supplying on the same price. So that's very important. So here, rather than impulse buy, you have to develop a relationship. So lots of visibility you have to create. Hey, how they can make more money? Why this is beneficial? How that makes sense? And like, it's not very easy for Udaan, because they have retailers who have existing relations from last 10, 15 years from the suppliers. Suddenly you are there and saying that, hey, I will supply all the goods, everything. Then they will be suspicious. Who is this Udaan? What is their existence? Tomorrow they will be there or not? If they will not be there, then what will do? Because their earnings, their family runs on that. So lots of deep problem solving, relation building. It's not about, hey, give the good price and then get it done. So that's the main fundamental you have to unlearn. Hey, don't give the best price. How to give more clarity. Learn things, how to develop those relations. We are learning.
Interesting. So when you look at that space and when you look at the key parameters, which is pricing, convenience, and also credit, right? Cheaper credit. Which of these three or a combination is the actual magic masala in this?
I must say that above all the three. Because retailer, like I said, pricing matters for them because they wanted to maximize their definitely earnings.
Yeah.
But not at the cost of quality. Convenience matters for them, but again, not at the cost of price. Credit matters to them, but not at the cost of selections or price. So all those things matters. So it's a combination. That's why we call it trade. So we are solving trade. And in trade, all these three things are combined. Pricing is also combined. Selection is also combined. Convenience is also a factor. And credit is the essential factor of it. So rather than calling it B2B, we are solving the trade. So that's our take.
Interesting. Now, talking of credit, you know, what is typically mentioned is that the moment you have a signboard saying you are willing to give credit, there's a queue of people who line up everywhere in this country, right? It has happened with FinTech, it has happened anywhere, the story is very similar. Yeah. So tell us about what kind of risk control, what measures do you have to make sure that, you know, on the credit side, these are investments well spent?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think like you say that if you'll give the credit, there are all the people who wanted to take it. Yeah. I think the magic lies how well you are going to recover it or why people will pay it. I think that is a very fundamental thing. And like I said, retailers are, they are running businesses. Their reputations matters a lot. If their name, their reputation spoils, it costs them dearly. And they default it also, but they default because when the non-compromising position of their reputation, if they see that nothing will going to happen, then they default. I think that's where the magic is. On the platform, when you have all the suppliers who matters to them are on your platform, when you know their network of locals, because that's a retailer have their own networks. So they understand if they will default, their reputation will going to be not good and might be they will not enjoy the credit terms with the other suppliers, kind of credit score. So as a platform, Udaan have that kind of structure where it can predict your worthiness and your behavior because we have all the data and that's why it's a technology play. And exactly how we do it, people take it and we give some kind of, it's not about leading through the credit. We see the behaviors. People start buying from cash and we see that how they are accepting it, not returning it, is it genuine or not? And then we start giving some credit, start again observing the behavior and then start building. But the fundamentals are how you are controlling that credit and which like they also understand, hey, if I'll not pay, then my suppliers, they will going to publish the whole, my behavior. So I think those things, that's why you should see NPAs are amazingly low because of that fear. Independently, if somebody only provides the credit, then that's the problem. Then you are not able to control their overall supplies and other relationships.
That's a great nuance in the market. I'm just curious, you know, given that we've had banks for decades, a financial system which has been evolving, you know, you work very deeply with the trade, particularly, you know, in the trade, you know, not in the top cities, you know, going down into the smaller cities. Where is our financial system? Where are the gaps in our financial system as far as trade is concerned?
I'll not comment on that. Where are the gaps? But I think some of this are learning, I can share that. I think one thing, while our executions, we have observed that if we'll make it, give them some kind of documents, give some ITR, you establish your identity, give so many documents, KYCs and all, they're not up for it. And most likely they will not qualify for the credit also because no credit, no history of paying taxes and all. Most of the small retailers of which where the 80% of people lies, and their most of transactions are in cash and all. Now with the Jandhan and the, all the accounts thing and the digitization of payments, definitely they have now account and credit history started. But the behavior is something which takes time. So independently assessing their credit worthiness is something which is never going to pass the process and they will not get the money. That's why most of the time when you go and ask for, hey, will you take the credit? They will say yes. But when your next question, hey, give me these documents, they're saying that's not possible. So through the data, once they have a relationship and once their suspicion disappears from the equations, they will give you the even the documents also. But at the first instance, it's very hard because I think alternatives are they have some relationship which provides credit to them. Though they don't know it's the best quality or best selections, those things. But if I think those things take time, hey, it can be decoupled. And that's where he's saying that, hey, they are giving the credit, though I wanted credit, but not at the cost of lots of hustle.
Got it. So let's switch gears and talk about your fundraising experience and the fastest unicorn tag which you've got. But more importantly, I think the question is around capital and large amount of capital being absorbed in an Indian company. Abundance of capital, if you might. And I wonder sometimes, what if that kind of capital were not available, what would you have done? So just talk us through the fundraising and the capital abundance part.
We haven't given ourselves a title fastest unicorn, but yeah, media has done some comparison. So I think when we have started, Ranu, we haven't raised the capital. We have put our own money. And definitely we coming from, like, we have seen in Flipkart, billions of dollars we have raised and being part of that process. Also, we have seen the trend, hey, why you require those kind of capital? Because there are anecdotes all across the world, be it Amazon or Alibaba. So those models were there, and that's why investors were paying that money. In B2B in India, there are no trends. Based on those trends and data, people will provide you the money. And there is no business model equivalent of what we are doing in all across the world, which give them the confidence, hey, give them that much of money. So we were aware of that. We started with our money. Given our kind of some execution experience and all, people definitely wanted to put money. But I still remember, it was more about the people rather than the business model. So they say that, hey, because of the history and their experience with the Flipkart, we can take a punt. But what they are doing must be doing good or something big, but currently it's not very clear. And we started the journey. I think things were started coming together. And as an investor started taking that 10 million, then seeing that all those growth and things were coming together, building capabilities, things were looking more real, then more capital. And then suddenly the whole opportunity, which was always there, like one, we always say that anything between 800 billion to 1 trillion kind of trade happened in this country, and that's the potential of this model. And earlier, I believe because of our law of the land, which was like GST was encouraging one to solve the B2B problem from the supply chain angle. Data, internet penetration was not there, so using of those retailers having an internet and using the internet for their businesses were not there. So I understand those belief and the business model were not there. But after Jio and all, data has really becoming penetrated to the village level, and people started using WhatsApp, and they started exploring the catalog in the trade. Suppliers forwarding them all the kind of catalogs. So they know how to browse catalogs, seeing the catalog, asking for the price, queries and all in established relationship. So I think all those things is about timing also.
Sure.
And then, like I said, then again growth, healthy growth, people start putting the money. And still, I think the fundamental difference in B2C and B2B, I also realize one thing. two kind of growth, how I see that. When you participate in pricing, like in B2C, and then definitely you are changing the buyer behaviors, and because it's coming on internet and buying and purchasing and consuming all the their day-to-day things, where the pricing is the leading mechanism how you change the behavior. In B2B, building capabilities like supply chain, solving the supply chain problem, solving the credit, how to lend, all those are building, like not only lending, then collection, mostly in the cash are big, so how to handle those cash, solving their catalog problem, solving their onboarding and then training, all those things. So investing in building those capability back end mostly, and then definitely discovery and all. B2B discoveries are very, very different. Let's say, I'll give one example. One shop, and might be I can give you the Bangalore example, let's say MG Road, which is selling clothing, and their ASP is from 1,000 rupees to 3,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees. But one shop, which is, let's say, Banargatta Road, their highest ASP is itself 500 rupees. They are also selling clothing. So what kind of selection you are offering? You cannot say the widest selection, relevant selection for that shop. So those capabilities are very, very different. So for one which is in MG Road, those 500 rupees doesn't make sense. That's like poor quality. And for the who's Banargatta Road shop, that's the like core of the purchase. So that's how, all those problems you have to solve. In consumer, that's not the point.
Sure. But going back to the question of fundraising, when you came in with such a high, having taken a company to 15 billion at Flipkart, the investors coming in obviously had that background, and even if you put in your own money, the big capital came by virtue of the track record, would you say? And the opportunity size, obviously.
I think validation of that opportunity. When we said that same opportunity, not with that clarity, because we are not having data. So at that time, it's very hard to believe. And definitely, it was not the day zero people have committed that much of capital. In that journey, they have seen how things were coming together. Trade, health, fundamentals, building capabilities. And that's where the serious money get committed. And we need more, because the opportunity, I feel, there is a much bigger opportunity in other ancillaries or kind of neighboring opportunities also, like SaaS as a solutions to all the retailers so that they can do their inventory management better, invoicing solutions, CRM, all those things. So there are so many things can be done.
Super. So let's now talk about the human part of Udaan, you know, the three of you coming together, all three of you, thick as thieves, I might say, VG more than yourself.
Yeah.
So how do you do the role play? How do you decide who does what, you know, having spent so much time with each other?
I think core of it is trust. So you cannot divide the role artificially, because as a person, you wanted to know everything.
Yeah.
I think trust is something where you can trust blindly trust on each other. And somebody who's taking the decision must be fair. And definitely everybody has their own strength. Like I can say that I enjoy operation, building scales, people. Definitely VG has a strength of is more analytical business, building business, a business finance guy. He was the head of the business finance. And definitely those are the strengths. Like Amod, he's a technology, he's one of the best tech talent in this country. So I think the faith is he will take the decision of building capability on technology wise. Is that the I lead with the faith. So that's how it is. But yeah, there are conflict happens, and with the transparency, we discuss it, we fight with each other. But at the end of the day, we understand, and relationship and trust help to reach the decision rather than taking a position or not budging from there. So I think that's where it's very crucial aspects.
So I think a very important insight in there for all the startups which have co-founders, trust and playing to each other's strengths, you know, kind of good long-term relationship. Now, tell us as Udaan kind of grows, you know, the people part of it, you know, it's breakneck speed, you are hiring people, maybe it'll love for people to know here what kind of, you know, numbers are hired, you know, just to, for people to get a sense. But how do you maintain the culture even if the company is kind of going at such kind of speed?
I'll give the some number aspects. So when we started in 2016, our first year we haven't like built kind of team. So three of us, there were initial, like on day zero, there were eight people, and the people were joining in the journey. And all those people, we had worked together in Flipkart. So again, trust has come into the play, and they have come, joined us because of faith, and they have seen us how leader or as a person, we have delivered our responsibility in Flipkart. And that with that faith, initial people have joined, and all of them were very senior. So in 2016, first 6 months, only we were devoted to understand the market, product fit, going on the ground, talking to retailers, suppliers, wholesalers, understanding their role, how it works, and every categories are very different. So 6 months only we have done that. We have launched our beta in November 2016, after having those research, and first beta came in 2000. For 7 months, it was in the private beta phase.
Interesting.
And again, we have learned after, because those products were started used by retailers and suppliers, manufacturers, wholesalers, and then we have refined our product. In 2017, June, after almost 1 year, we have started our operation. And that's the real journey. So which is only 2.5 years, how I see that. In the 2.5 years, from around 50, 60 people, currently we are 2,700 people and 27,000 people.
Wow.
So there are around 29,000 people.
Wow.
So 27, why? Because which you call they on roll, but we call that off roll, like executive is the delivery executives, collections, feet on the street. Though they are not on our payroll, but on with our partner's payroll, but principally we are the employer. So we call them associates. The numbers are 27,000. So 29,000, around 29,000 people are there.
So that's like what, 40x, 400x, is it? From in 3 years' time?
Two and a half years, it's like, very, yeah, I think,
yeah.
300
400 times.
300, 400 times.
So how are you managing such growth and such hiring in 3 years? I'm not sure whether at Flipkart you did the same kind of velocity.
Yeah. No, I not with the same speed, but I've left Flipkart at that time also in my team around 30,000 people. So that's why I'm saying that it was a continuation. Those confidence were always there because we have reached that 30,000 in 7-8 years. So same thing, like people issues, processes, all those you don't have to invent. Similar kind of job. So that's where we have leveraged our experience, what we had in Flipkart, and that has given us the confidence to scale fast. Maintaining culture and all, I say that it's something, culture and something, everything like execution and other thing aspects, it starts from the bottom in the organization. Culture and something is from top. What you are, you cannot hide yourself. Doesn't matter what you say, people observe you 24/7. And they understand what you say, they don't understand that. What they see, they understand.
Absolutely.
So the gap between what you say and what you are, if that's very, very narrow, there is definitely going to be a difference. But if that's narrow and close to the reality, then you manage your culture with the predictability. Otherwise, you will be surprised always. Hey, I said something, do all these things, but you are not living up to what you are saying. And people observe that.
That's again, wonderful to know that culture is so top down, you know, starting with the founders and then the senior management, then percolating down. So what I'll do is I'll ask one more question and then, you know, we'll open it to the audience. You know, we'd have a few minutes for any questions which the audience might have a few. So tell us about what is Udaan going to be like 5 years from now? What is the vision? What is it going to be?
It's very hard to predict with the journey of three and a half years predicting 5 years. But yeah, aspiration, I can say it. Like I said, B2B, commerce is something that we are solving the problem. And in that, Udaan, in next 5 years, it will be, I'll give any anecdotes. In 2008, when we started the journey of Flipkart, we were only selling books. Nobody would have imagined after five years, We have shut that category and we are selling something else. So we, if you have asked that question in 2008, how it will look like in 2013?
Books and more books.
More books. And that's how you must have said that I will control 100% and how. But I have seen nothing to do with the books, rather than you have entered all the category and set that category. Right. So it's what I'm saying, what you are today say, I don't think so it will hold, but we will be in the center of the commerce. And if there is and there is a reality, if there is 1 trillion, and which is also growing by somebody saying that 12% CAGR, will be significant portion of that. Like currently, if you'll see, it will point some percent. I think we'll be the early double digit of the trade. I think that's our inspiration.
That's wonderful, and it's heartening to see entrepreneurs who want to create businesses of such high impact and high scale in a country where the problems have been in execution for quite a few. So we'd like to play a little game here, okay, Sujit? So I'll ask you, I'll put some 4 prompts, and you have to say the 1 word which comes to your mind as soon as you can, okay? So we'll play that and then open it to the audience for questions.
Yeah.
Let's start easy. Tycon.
It's lots of entrepreneurs are here, and they learn and exchange.
It's 1 word. You have to say only 1 word.
Summit of entrepreneurs.
Okay. We'll take that. Credit.
Tough.
Banks.
Reality. Banks. It's very hard to say. I'm NBFC.
Don't worry, we're all figuring out what banks are.
Yeah. Far from reality, let's put it like
that. Here's the last one. SoftBank.
Big believer. Sometime mistake happens.
Yeah. Well, that's wonderful. So enlightening to kind of learn all these from you, from your experiences and insights. And we'll open it to the audience for any questions. We have just a few minutes. So if you could keep your questions very brief, and questions and not comments, ideally. I think there is a mic going around, so.
Yeah.
Hello, Sujit. Hi.
Hello.
Morning. So my question is that with your latest fund round, you had said that you would be entering in the food space from B2B. So could you shed some light on that?
Yeah, we are already in the food space. We call it staples, FMCG, and fresh. And we are in the pharma also. We are in around 30 cities and scaling it. In some of the cities, we have scaled like Bangalore and NCR. And that's what I'm saying. Nothing to do with my previous learning. It's very different. I haven't done anything related to food supply chain. And that's what I'm learning. And we are in that journey, again, toughest part, how to, with the low margin, high weightage category, how to solve the supply chain. And that's what we are learning currently. But we are the largest food e-commerce company, you can say that. We are handling almost around on daily basis more than 7,000 tons of supply chain only in food. So, yeah. But there are lots of things to do. Okay. Fresh is the toughest category. Like fresh is very hard. There is a principle of accounting, 3-way of reconciliation, IRN, GRN, PO. I think somebody will understand it. But in fresh, because PO is not there, there is a shrinkage on the source, which is around 7-10%. So there can't be PO. So accounting problem, and that's learning. We don't know how to solve it. But we are in the process of how to solve the, especially for fresh, not for the staples and FMCG. So all those are the fundamental problems. If you'll not solve it, then you'll not grow it.
Also, right now I understand that Udaan is in scaling stage, but is profitability in sight for the, like, you know, in next 5 years?
So, yes. We see that behavior, how the cohorts are looking. Let's say, currently, in our overall spread of, we see that category food and non-food. In non-food, we are in 900 cities, we supply our goods. And in foods, 30 cities, because you have to build from scratch. We see that pattern of in how many lanes and how many city capacity utilizations coming together and economics making sense. Let's say 1 year back, if 20% of the overall volume and the, your networks are making and gross margin positive GM1, GM2, and then EBITDA level, then that percentage has to grow in that journey. And then it's up to you how you want it to grow faster. If you grow faster, your network that 20 to, you can go up to 60%, but if you wanted to grow faster, only you can grow from 20 to let's say 20, 40%. So that's how we see that. So profitability, you should be in command rather than you don't have any clue how to do it.
So I think the monitor shows the time's up, but maybe one last question.
Hello?
I have the mic.
Yeah, good morning, Sujit sir. This is Shubham.
Hello.
So just for your information, I have completed my graduation, post-graduation with 3 months of internship with Udaan itself.
Oh.
Yeah. So that time I had one question, so just wanted to ask, like Udaan guarantees that within less than 49 rupees, you deliver the stuff to the retailer or the to the trade person, right? So how do you manage that? Within 2 days of this thing, you deliver into within 49 rupees. So how do you manage that thing? Just wanted to know that.
One, you have to understand, if you'll ask for a supply chain, might be our costs are more, but we, let's say, charge 50 rupees. Our, let's say, order size is 100 kg, and that's, our, let's say, our overall, for food, I'm saying. And currently, their math is working, they pay around 50 to 60 paisa per kg. If you'll ask more than that, they will not pay. I think that's the simple math. We have to figure it out how to work on that cost so that it should make money. But if you today, if your cost, like, I'm just making it up. If your cost is, let's say, 100 rupees, if you ask 100 rupees, you will not pay because from 50 paisa, it's going 1 rupees and they will not pay. So we call it cost to the scale. Once you'll, and I think beauty is when you start growing, you have to figure it out in some of the cohorts, like I said, 20%, that 50 rupees is coming, 50 paisa is coming or not.
It's so, so given that the times, you know, where we don't have time for any more questions, but I'm sure if you find Sujit around this evening, ask him whatever you can offline. So thanks again, Sujit. Congratulations on setting a new benchmark in India in terms of creation. More importantly, creating a business with real impact at the grassroots level in India, which aims to shake the trade and make it more profitable and relevant. So congratulations again.
Thanks, Ranu, and thanks, Thaikon. You for invitation. I was not very sure one week back I will come or not. I think Ranu has invited me to come. I think Bangalore people, it's very hard to come and in Delhi, in Mumbai. And but I have an office here, and thanks. I will visit my office also. I'll meet my people. So thank you.
Great.
Thank you, Sujit. I'm still getting my head around 30,000 employees. That's incredible. And Ranu, congratulations. Half marathon in less than 2 hours. That's incredible. Round of applause. And I would request our session chair, Mahavir Lunawat, to please... Oh, he's right here. Hi. So can you please felicitate our dignitaries? Can we please take center stage for a group photo? And also, I would request Atulji and Amit Mukim to please step forward to felicitate our session chair. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you're taking a lot of pictures and videos. Make sure that you use our hashtag on all our social media platforms. It's hashtag TyconMumbai. Hashtag TyconMumbai. Okay.